Hi there, YouTubers. Hey, let's start a weaving project. And I think you can probably guess what it's going to be because you saw the video that I did a few days ago for the cone winder, and you could see the colors, at least, that I was working with, and I mentioned that I was going to be doing warp rep. Well, I've done a bunch of threading. I've got the loom threaded. The warp is all wound on the back beam, and I'll show you in a second, but I've been starting to pull the threads through on the heddles and to get things all tied up. So we'll take a good look at that, and then I'll come back and talk to you about what is warp rep. So let's just take a look. There you can see, if the light's not too bad because there's a lot of sun from the outside, but there's my threads that I'm putting on. That's all I've got left. Out of it's going to be a 23 inch wide piece. So let's talk about warp rep for a minute. Now, what is warp rep? Warp rep is a very heavily warp faced weave. So what you're going to see in the end result is predominantly the warp threads and very, very little of the weft threads. You might catch a little bit where it goes around the end at the edge, and just an occasional sneak hint at it in the piece. And what is warp rep used for? Well, quite often it's used as placemats or as table runners, or in what I'm planning on doing is a small rug. Actually, I'm going to make, hopefully I've got enough to be two. I think my cell phone just went off. Oh well. Yep, there's the cell phone. I'll get back to that in a minute. So warp rep, I'm going to use it for a couple of rugs. Hopefully they'll be about a yard long and 23 and a half inches wide. But the thing that's interesting about warp rep is that you use two different weft threads, one of them being very thick and the other one being very thin, and you alternate them. And you'll see this when I actually get to weaving, but let's just talk about it now for a second. So what that means is that because one's real thick, the warp threads going over that thick weft have a long float, relatively speaking. The ones going over the thin weft have a very short float on the top. So you get the predominance of whichever threads go over the top of the thick weft. And that means that you can, if the colors of one set of warp and the other are different, you can get an effect of showing one color over another. And that's what I'm going to try to do here. So let's take a look at the back of the loom just to give you an idea of how much I've got wound on. And then we'll take a look at how I'm pulling things through. I'll finish doing that and we'll get on to the weaving pretty soon. Alright, so here I am at the front of the loom, and again, I know it's a little bit dark because I've got such bright light behind, but I think you can see at least these threads back here that I'm pulling through as warp threads. What's different is, if you remember the way I was working with that cone holder to do my warping, was that I was working in groups of four. So what that means is that back here in the cross, I've got groups of four threads in the cross instead of every thread alternating between one side of the cross on the leaf sticks and the other. I've got four threads on one side, the leaf sticks, then another four, then another four. So when I'm pulling them through, I'm working with four threads at the cross level instead of just one on each side. Now I'm still threading in my heddles, one thread per heddle. So that part's not the same. The only difference is at the cross, and I don't think that's going to be a problem. When I took the class at Vavstuga, she talked about doing it this way, and it seemed to work out just fine from the way she said it at the class. So I'm trying this. It does seem to go a little bit, it did seem to go faster at the warping, at the warp measuring stage. So, and at this point it doesn't seem to have changed in any, and actually it's a little bit faster, but not much at this point, threading the heddles. So there's what I've got. There goes my cell phone again. Anyways, so this is the warp rep, and you can kind of see here that I've got blocks that will turn into blocks of color. And then I've got a big block of going to be kind of the reddish color. And then right in here, there's going to be a block of the grayish. Anyways, that's the plan. I'm going to finish pulling the warp threads through the heddles and then through the reed. And we'll get on to weaving in a little bit. Alrighty, there's my threading chart telling me which ones go on which. So shaft 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And what I've done, you probably can't see it, but the colors, I've listed the ones that are the kind of reddish, have red ink and yellow background, and the ones, the gray has just black ink. So the next one is going to be a set of 12, each on shafts 1 and 4. With the reddish color going on shaft 4. So, since I'm working in groups of 4 threads, I'll pull out 2 each from shaft 1 and 4. And I always start with the one farther back. So let's put all the rest of this stuff back there so we can just work with one set. So there's the red. And the gray, I realize it's not a true red, but it's redder than the gray. So that's how I'm thinking of it as red, even though it's kind of a maroon. Okay, so there's the threads from the first group of 4. Stupid cell phone. Pull out another 2. You guys are going to get tired of hearing minute call, aren't you? So now we'll do one more set and then I'll turn the camera off and really get to working on this. 1, 2, there you go, you get the idea. This gets boring if you just keep looking at it. It gets boring for me even as I'm doing it. So there's 8 threads through the heddles, and you can see this is a batch where the grayish color is at the front. So, okay, the loom is fully warped up, and I have started weaving on this warp rep piece. And I must admit, I made a couple mistakes in my warping up the loom, and I did a little bit of sampling and was not happy, and I unwove about 2 or 3 inches, which isn't a lot considering it's warp rep because it only takes 6 picks per inch, and it was only maybe 2 inches I unwove, so it wasn't bad. I had a little trouble wrapping my brain around the block theory for warp rep, and it should really be easy because it's tabby, but it's tabby with 2 colors and 4 blocks, and I don't know, my brain just didn't want to accept it real easily. So I did a couple things to help myself. And for one, I went and spent a few dollars and downloaded from Interweave Rosalie Nielsen's video on how to do warp rep. I found it helpful. It wasn't fantastic, but it certainly was helpful. And I'm also working from one of her patterns in an old issue of Handwoven magazine. So even though I'm not using it to do the same kind of piece she did. She used this pattern for a table runner, and I'm using it for a rug. The concept is still the same, the basic structure of it. So let's take a look first at a little chart that I drew up for myself, partly on the computer and partly with magic marker, that's just helping me keep things straight in my head. I'm going to turn on the light so you can see better by the loom and aim the camera down. So here's my chart. And basically what I'm showing, if it doesn't slide away on me, okay, we'll try this again. Here's the chart. And this pattern has got four blocks that can produce pattern where I either have gray on top or reddish on top. So where I've got the gray on top, I'm leaving it plain white, and where I've got the reddish color on top, I've colored in with pink. So my first block is this top two pink lines that I'm calling block A. The second block is block B, and that's got this here. Block C is that, and block D is that on the bottom. So A, B, C, D. And then after I finally got my tie up straight, and I had a missed tie as well, so I crawled under the loom and fixed that. Then I figured out, okay, in order to get block A, what petals do I have to push? So to get block A, I have to have petal 9 down when I'm doing a thick warp, and petal 5 down when I'm doing a thin weft, not warp, weft. For B, I need petal 6 down for thick, petal 10 down for thin. C is 5 down for thick, 9 down for thin. D is 10 down for thick, 6 down for thin. And in a couple of my previous videos, I've shown you the petals underneath the loom. The one I can think of most quickly is the blue and white towels one, where I showed how I use the petals. So you get the idea what I mean by down. It's basically which petal am I pushing on. So here's my plan, showing my four possible block combinations. Now let's take a look at it on the loom. And what I've done is I started out by just doing a small sample. And I'm going to put a couple pieces of wood here so you can see. I don't know if the light helps or hurts. I think it almost hurts. Okay, here's block A. And I only did three rows of each block, which is six picks of each block. So there's block A. Now you can see the difference between block A and B, because in block A we've got this little gray square in the middle, but in block B it's got the reddish color, the wine color, all the way across the center. And you can see also in A we've got these two little blocks here, plus the red there, and here we've got gray in those areas, okay? So now let's go to block B only and open up block C. Block C is got gray across most of the middle with a red square in the middle, or a wine-colored square in the middle. And block D is got the gray all across the center, but red, gray, red. And if you look, basically let's go down to here and take a look. Here's block B, where we've got the red all the way across, and here's block D, where we've got the gray all the way across. So B and D are opposites of each other, and A and C are opposites of each other. So, anyways, this is the little sample that I did. I did it for a couple reasons like this. One, that I'm going to put this in my weaving notebook as a record of my sample. And two, I wanted to measure how many picks it took me to get approximately an inch, because that's what I'm going to use throughout the rest of this for the rug, to know how big to make my areas. My squares, my blocks are about 3/4 of an inch wide, so if I make them an inch this way, it's going to be an inch by 3/4 of an inch. It'll come out looking approximately symmetrical. So that was the goal. That's the sample. I've used only thin threads as a header here and a header here for weft. But in this area, you can see where I've used the thick white thread as a weft, alternated with a thin red thread. There's my red thin thread, which is the same thread as my warp. And for my thick thread, what I'm using is 4 strands of the, I think it's called peaches and cream, or sugar and spice or something like that. You get it at Walmart. And it's just a cotton thing. It's the kind of thing that you would make hot pads out of on a hooking type weave. But I'm using it just as weft. So there's really just 4 strands. 1, 2, 3, 4, you can see them. There we are. 4 strands of that. And that makes up my thick weft. And if I alternate thick and thin, that's how we get it to look like a block there. So that's the theory and the sampler. And now I'll get back to weaving a little bit more of the thin-only header, because right at this point I'm going to switch over and start working on the header for the first rug I want to get off of this pattern. And I'll come back and show you what that looks like after I get a bit more done. Well, I think I've mentioned a few times, and I'm going to remind everybody one more time, that warp rep weaving requires 2 different size weft threads. And you can see my 2 different sizes in my hand. The big white one, which is really 4 strands, and the smaller wine-colored maroon one, red, whatever you want to call it. Okay, so I'm about to take a one shot across with the thin thread. There we go. And then we'll go down here. Now, sometimes I have to bring this up close, and I'm using this little wooden stick. Some people call them swords. It's a sawed off half an old yardstick that I've sanded on the edges. Now, here's the problem I've run out of my current batch of weft. So what I'm going to do is take my scissors, see where it comes to, and I'm going to cut it back a couple inches from there. Okay, now we're open up to where I want it to be. We'll come to there. I'm just picking a place. It doesn't have to be exactly the same place. And come over to about here, and we'll pull that through. So what we've got, I'll go under the end of that, is 4 strands of weft going this far, and only 2 strands of weft going this far. Now we'll take the new batch of weft. That's what happens with this type of shuttle. So let's go to here and pull out 2 of the threads. And then we'll go to here and pull out the other two. What that leaves us with then is, I went over two threads. We have four of the old weft here, two of the new and two of the old here, and four of the new here. So we have a nice even weft for our heavy weft. Get that down. Move this across. Beat that down. And we'll put the thin one through. Then we'll go back with the thick one again. Finally, the thin one, one last time for this part of the video. So I hope you can see that I am doing alternating thick wefts and thin wefts. So bring the camera up here. I think what I'm going to do is end the video at this point, even though I'm not done with the weaving. I want to get this up onto YouTube. Let you take a look at it, and I'll do another video of the finishing of this project and show you the final product when I get to that point. But I wanted to get something done, get something up on YouTube at this point. So thanks for watching. If you're a subscriber, I really do appreciate the fact that you have subscribed. If you've just stumbled across my channel and you're not a subscriber, I certainly would appreciate if you do subscribe. Thanks much for watching, and bye-bye.